The imperialistic Roman Empire was a social and political powerhouse that brought concrete to the world and refined hygiene standards with their drainage systems and sewers. The list of accomplishments is vast and eye-opening. The same can be said about the putrid practices and unusual events that took place during its time in the sun. I'm Jake the Voice Parr, and these are 10 things you probably didn't know about the Roman Empire. If there was one Roman emperor who was despised by his subjects, then it would have to be Elagabalus. Even though he was a mere teenager, he was a sadistic hedonist with a very cruel sense of humor. Rich folk dined on some pretty exotic food at the time, like flamingo brains. Elagabalus served pheasant heads, parrots, raw fish guts, and even rocks covered with wax to closely resemble fruit. It is said that in 221 AD, he unleashed a pack of lions and leopards in a dining room full of guests. His pranks were considered horrible and dangerous. Not only did he drop copious amounts of coins into crowds, he even unleashed a pack of poisonous snakes during numerous gladiator games. Many were crushed or poisoned. Elagabalus was assassinated at age 18, after only 4 years in power. As he cowered with his mother, they were both decapitated and had their corpses dragged around in public. Elagabalus was dumped in the Tiber River. Unsurprisingly, few mourned his premature death. Ancient Rome never saw civilians carrying weapons into towns and cities as a threat or danger, and thus, this practice was not banned. Weirdly though, sausages were outlawed. Before the Roman Empire subjugated them, the Greeks loved sausages. They would chomp away at the meaty treats during gladiatorial contests. In 320 AD, Emperor Constantine I banned sausages. The reason? It was associated with pagan festivals. The Romans loved them very much, and would buy and sell them in secret until the ban was finally lifted. While Roman doctors had herbal antiseptics for open wounds, they had no anesthetics. Surgery was very painful and sometimes fatal. Those stricken with serious diseases were sent to an Asclepian, where the gods were expected to cure them. Otherwise, luckier folk with less serious conditions might have gone to the luxurious bathhouses. Some theories on the origins of sickness and disease were based on common sense. Columella blamed open sewers and swamps. Varro thought microscopic creatures naked to the human eye were the cause. We know them today as bacteria and viruses. Others thought it was their gods or the stars punishing them. While the Romans relied on clinical observation and experimented with herbal remedies, not all of their attempts at curing patients were based on common sense. Some cures involved crushing poisonous spiders and feces into venomous bites. A recommended cure for epilepsy was to drink the blood of fallen gladiators, which was used for almost half a millennium. A philosopher and physician hailing from Greece, Galen moved to Rome and continued his medical work there. His work was the stuff of legends at the time, and long after his death. Galen was lucky enough to work with injured gladiators and had a few opportunities to dissect the corpses of a few humans. As a result, he found out quite a lot regarding major internal organs. Otherwise, most of his findings on human anatomy were based on cutting open dogs, pigs, and bipedal apes. Thus, he believed humans had the same anatomy as all these animals. On top of that, since he believed in the four humors, a Greek hypothesis where an imbalance of blood, phlegm, black, and yellow bile would have resulted in illness, no one dared to look any further into it. In fact, until the 18th century, doctors blindly followed the sometimes inaccurate teachings of Galen and dared not question such a cult of personality in the field of medicine. While we named our planets in the solar system after many of the Romans' major gods and goddesses, there were a fair share of minor ones who were associated with some mundane or gruesome stuff. There were deities associated with each direction where the wind blew. Cardia and Mina were goddesses of door hinges and menstruation, respectively. Robigo was associated with corn, and Potina's sphere was children's drinks. The list is pretty extensive and is awfully specific. One can only imagine that these beings must have plucked the short straws. The wealthy loved to dye their clothes. A color that was most sought after was Tyrian purple, a dark shade of purple that looked bright and beautiful on white robes. It was incredibly expensive to make because it was made of crushed sea snails. They contained a special gland that produced this color. Hundreds upon thousands of these unlucky mollusks were splattered in order to dye a single robe. And who said the Romans never had a passion for fashion? Romans were gluttonous. They loved to eat, even if they were full. They were so lazy that they even went to the toilet in a chamber pot in front of everyone, so not to miss out on any conversations. Emetic cups helped the elite empty their stomachs so they could eat more. These goblets were often made of poisonous substances like mercury and had wine poured inside them so that it would absorb the nasty stuff. After a sip from one of these goblets, it would rush off to a special room to throw up, and then, shortly afterwards, resume where they left off. Not all historians in ancient Rome had the clearest of memories, and some never bothered writing things down. Often, they were recited by memory. Roman historian Pliny wrote that around the 5th century BC, 500 years before he was even born, Roman legionnaires were paid with little more than salt. This is not entirely true. Members of the Roman army were indeed paid with salt, but they were also given money, rations, a place to live, insane training regimens to keep them as fit as possible, and were allowed to keep anything they looted after battle. Their gear had to be purchased separately, however. Otherwise, they were awarded salt. We take salt for granted these days, but back then, it was highly sought after because it was the only way of preserving meat for a long time. If you were a poor denizen of the Roman Empire, you lived in a small, flammable house and dined on vegetables almost every day. The father of each household called the shots. When it came to children, they would leave any unwanted babies on the sidewalk to let them die, or hope that someone would adopt them as a slave. Older children were sometimes sold to wealthier families to become slaves. Otherwise, if they were no longer wanted, their father would personally kill them. Thankfully, this was outlawed after the turn of the 1st century. Next time you complain about your dad being strict, be thankful that he's not a Roman. You're in for a gross fact. The Romans dyed their clothes with human urine, which helped dissolve grease stains, and even brushed their teeth with it to give their choppers a glossy white color. Too bad about the smell. That's not all. They gave urine to sick pets and grew crops with it. While it was said to make fruits like pomegranates juicier, apparently urine from the elderly was most effective, it was mixed with feces and made into plant fertilizer, which helped spread nasty diseases. Still, plants absorbed the organic minerals lost in the bodily waste and thrived. Talk about a golden way to end this list. Those then are 10 things you probably didn't know about the Roman Empire. For more top lists just like this, be sure to leave a like and subscribe if you haven't already. Don't forget to check out our other top lists. Thank you very much for watching, and thanks for learning.